As a labor movement, we can play a leading role in confronting this climate crisis by supporting mobilization efforts and advocating for the changes that are urgently needed to create a better future for everyone. And that is what we are here to do.
I could make all sorts of arguments about scientific arguments about why Canada should transition away from fossil fuels. To me, it's the economic argument. Right now, parts of the country, Alberta, is making an extremely risky bet on something that all of the global models say, if the rest of the world gets serious about acting on climate change, there's not going to be any market for what's being produced.
By continuing to hold these fossil fuel companies in your pension portfolios, you are effectively betting against your own grandkids. If your bet wins, it's only because they lose. You will have staked your pension returns on a future in which they reside in a hellscape.
Can pension funds be mobilized like the rest of society and resources to meet the climate emergency with determination and urgency? Can they be enlisted to support conversion? This isn't going to be popular if we adopt a move away from the current approach that pension funds and institutional investors much prefer, and move toward the serious directed approach that Seth Klein was referring to.
These pension funds have close to $3 trillion in assets to invest. In many cases, union-appointed trustees have an equal voice in the governance of these funds, including investment decisions.
We have, for some of our members, very long-term perspectives. There aren't very many institutions in the world that do have long-term perspectives. Right? And what do we do with that? We say, look, we're here for the long term. We're investing for the long term. Our liabilities reach out for the long term. And as long-term investors, we have a different perspective. We see 2030 as imminent. We see 2050 as very soon.
But this point that has been raised before is worth reiterating. If because of campaign pressure, you sell a share, someone will buy it and probably resell it for a profit. In this system of capitalism, there will always be indifferent or unethical investors to pick up the share. So the share just trades hands and the company doesn't lose money. But to be fair, many divestment campaign leaders do recognize this and frame the goal as going after the social license of fossil fuel companies, for example. And to that end, I do think it's effective.
The status quo is destroying the security and livelihoods of tens of thousands of fossil fuel workers. And we have to be 100% sure that we're on the side of those workers and all workers with a program that we know is doable. No new fossil fuel investments and finding ways to use our power in the pension industry to facilitate that transition.
We would all like to see a different kind of society, more free, more just society. But the timescale for that and the timescale for urgent action are very different. We have to get over the immediate crises. We know how to do it. The means are available.
So when workers do stand up and ask for better, then things shift and change. But the problem is like Professor Chomsky was talking about, we live in an economy that is a ransom economy. We're not allowing people to feel as though they have the free will to speak out. We are stuck in this, as you've stated, this master and the subservient people sort of framework in our society. But we have all the power, particularly the workers have all the power to shift things, but we have to be able to take the stands.
Reflecting on what Professor Noam Chomsky said yesterday, organized labor has historically been in the forefront of struggles for social justice and human welfare. The topic of this conference is the most significant in human history, literally a matter of survival. If humans are to prevail, the labor movement must play a leading role.
Now is the time to move. Now is the time to act. Time is not on our hands, but the power to change our future is.